Examples of petrological and geochemical studies of volcanic plumbing systems. A. High-precision chemical analysis and element mapping using a field emission gun electron probe microanalyzer. B. Thin section of a zoned plagioclase crystal, zonation indicated by dashed line, in basalt of the 2015 Huleron eruption. Crossed polars. Crystal ca. 1 mm across. Crystal textures can be used to reconstruct processes in the volcanic plumbing system. C. Scanning electron microscope, SEM, image of vesiculated xenolith erupted offshore El Hierro. D. False color SEM image of a zoned clinopyroxene crystal in lava erupted at Huleron, Iceland. Zones and inclusions can be used to reconstruct processes in the volcanic plumbing system. E. Results of geobarometric modeling of plagioclase and clinopyroxene in tephras from Kotla volcano, Iceland. F. Mineralogy of pyroxene crystals in Kotla tephras. G. Analyzing trace element contents in igneous rocks. Image courtesy of Christophe Galerne. H. ZR versus NB plot of igneous rocks and xenoliths from the Canary Islands, Spain. Trace element compositions can be used to understand the origin of, and relationships between, rock groups. Geophysical studies of volcanic plumbing systems employ a variety of methods, figure 4, that detect and quantify either the physical properties of different geomaterials, such as magma versus solid rock or igneous versus sedimentary rocks, or the effects of active physical processes, such as seismicity caused by the movement of magma through the crust. Geophysical methods are therefore applied to study both active volcanoes and extinct subsurface or eroded plumbing systems. Examples of geophysical studies of volcanic plumbing systems. A. Seismicity related to the emplacement of a dike preceding caldera collapse in Miyajima volcano, Japan, in 2010, see references therein for source data. B. And C. Linear gravity anomalies, marked by black dots, interpreted to be related to dikes on the moon. D. Above, vertical section of a 3D seismic dataset showing the signal related to a sill. Below, 3D seismic image of the same saucer-shaped sill. E. Volcanic plumbing system of the Toba caldera inferred from seismic tomography. In order to characterize physical properties of different materials in the crust, a wide range of geophysical methods, such as gravimetry, magnetometry, and electrics, are commonly applied to map volcanic plumbing systems and associated hydrothermal systems. These methods detect anomalies in the Earth's gravimetric, magnetic, and electrical resistivity fields. The anomalies are caused by the presence of rock types with properties contrasting to those of the surrounding country rocks, for example, higher or lower density, resistivity, etc., depending on the type and size of target, for example, mapping a granitic intrusion, and the expected depth range of the target. Appropriate methods and acquisition techniques are chosen. Instruments may be mounted on airplanes and satellites or installed in arrays at the Earth's surface. Acquired geophysical data can then be used to map the physical properties of the Earth's crust. Such maps allow locating the extent and map the outline of magmatic intrusions, which is extremely useful for large-scale reconnaissance and mapping in poorly exposed or inaccessible areas, such as moons or other planets, for example. The spatial resolution of the data mainly depends on the contrast in physical properties between the target and the country rock. The acquired data on geophysical anomalies can also be used in inversion models that infer the subsurface distribution of a particular physical property by reproducing the pattern and magnitude of the anomaly, making simple assumptions about the geology, for example, homogeneity and isotropy of the involved rocks. For instance, the results of inversion models can be applied to determine the subsurface shape and volume of a granitic intrusion, for example. The main limitation of geophysical mapping at depth using inversion modeling is that the data are acquired at the Earth's surface, more or less in 2D, is then used to interpret the 3D distribution of physical properties. Moreover, inversion modeling that often produces as very similar solutions in spite of different input parameters. Hence, the number of fitting solutions may be infinite, and thus, model interpretations are often non-unique. Geophysical methods are also frequently applied to study active volcanoes in order to locate magma storage levels and to infer processes related to magma movement. For instance, microgravimetry monitoring can be applied to detect magma flow into the plumbing system by monitoring changes in the local gravimetric field, a method often combined with geodetic monitoring. In the brittle crust, volcano tectonic earthquakes that are interpreted to be related to magma movement are studied in the subdiscipline of volcano seismology. Using a network of seismometers, seismicity in active volcanoes can be monitored, for example, to trace propagating sheet intrusions, which gives valuable insight into dike emplacement mechanisms. The properties of seismic waves, frequencies, waveforms, etc., can be interpreted to derive information about processes such as the rise of magma in a conduit or the intrusion of a cryptodome. Travel times of seismic waves through the crust beneath a volcano can be used as input parameters for inversion models, a technique called seismic tomography. The seismic velocity structure of a volcano can be used to map subsurface areas with an increased percentage of melt, potentially corresponding to magma reservoirs. However, the detection limit of seismic tomography for magma bodies is on the order of several hundred meters, depending on the seismic array and acquisition conditions on the one hand and the structure of the individual volcano on the other. Therefore, most parts of the volcanic plumbing system, such as average-sized dikes and sills, may be undetectable using seismic tomography. During the last decade, seismic reflection and refraction have been extensively implemented to image volcanic plumbing systems in sedimentary basins. While all geophysical methods described earlier employ passive measurements of natural rock properties, seismic reflection and refraction methods represent active geophysical surveying. Acoustic waves are sent into the subsurface and reflected and refracted at interfaces between rocks of contrasting impedance. Thus, the resulting seismic images are a direct echography of subsurface structures and not the result of data inversion. Initially designed for studying the structure of sedimentary basins and hydrocarbon exploration, seismic data proved essential to document the presence of voluminous sill and laccolith complexes in numerous basins worldwide. On seismic images, igneous intrusions are very prominent because of the strong impedance contrast between igneous and sedimentary rocks. The main advantages of seismic data are that, 1, they can image the shapes of entire intrusions in 3D, which can potentially constrain magma flow directions, and, 2, it is possible to constrain the intrusion scale deformation induced by magma emplacement and intrusion fault interactions. The main limitations of seismic data are, 1, the limited spatial resolution, about 20 to 40 meters, 2, the limited possibility to image subvertical features, such as dikes, 3, seismic artifacts that produce interpretable features that do not exist, and, 4, the availability of the seismic data, as they are often kept confidential by oil companies. Geophysical methods are thus powerful tools to study physical properties and signals produced by processes of volcanic plumbing systems. Despite their limitations, these methods are often the only way to derive information about the location and properties of plumbing systems at depth. Volcano observatories monitor active volcanoes with a combination of techniques, including seismic networks, temperature, and gas monitoring, as well as geodetic techniques, www.wovo.org, Figure 5. Geodetic monitoring of the deformation of the Earth's surface relies mainly on ground-based tilt meters, GPS networks, and satellite-based interferometry of synthetic aperture radar, in SAR. A network of GPS stations has to be deployed and maintained in the field and typically delivers daily data for each station. Continuous monitoring can provide surface deformation data with an accuracy of about 1 mm/year, but the data quality strongly depends on the station network density. On the other hand, in SAR records surface deformation in the line of sight of the satellite at 10 to 40 days intervals. So, an SAR can reach accuracies of less than 1 cm for a stack of interferograms. Apart from disturbances due to vegetation and glaciation, an SAR allows geodetic monitoring of volcanoes worldwide, irrespective of accessibility. Thanks to an SAR monitoring data, we now know of more than 140 currently deforming volcanoes, http://www.globalvolcanomodel.org. The corrected and processed surface deformation data are interpreted using geodetic volcano deformation modeling, which reproduces the pattern and magnitude of the surface signal with analytical models based on fluid and solid mechanics. The results of geodetic models have been used to interpret volcano deformation in many volcanoes worldwide and have led to a better understanding of magma movements.